Hallelujah, Lord. Today I want to say I need more of you. I desire more of you, Lord. I'm thirsty for you, Spirit. I'm thirsty for you, Lord Jesus Christ. I desire more of you. I desire you, Lord. I long for you. Nakutamani Baba, nakutamani Yesu. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Now, today I want to talk about a very simple thing. Progressing in God, amen? Say progressing.
Progressing.
Progressing in God.
Progressing.
Now, God desires that each one of us progresses. And when I talk about progression, I'm not talking about finances, because many times we think progress is money. I'm talking about progressing in every way. You can't be this year having the same level of wisdom you had last year. You can't be this year having the same level of education that you had last year. You can't be this year being in the same level that you were last year when it comes to your health. There must be a progress. You must determine that you're going to progress, because our God is a God of progress. If you look at the Bible, God never talked much about the past. When he's talking about the past, he's reminding people of what he did. But much more, he talks about the future. He wants to see you in the future. Now, if God was looking at you like he was looking at Gideon, he doesn't see you the way you are now. He sees you in the future. And sometimes I'm impressed by politicians, because they have five-year plans. Somebody's already talking about 2022 now. You're talking about lunch. The guy is talking about 2022. They are already strategizing. When they go to their boardrooms, they are strategizing about how they are going to win 2022. And unfortunately, as believers, we don't see far. We don't want to ask God, where are you seeing me in the next 10 years? Where are you seeing my children in the next 5 years? Where are you seeing me? Because God cannot be able to take you where you can't see. One has spirit. God cannot progress you where you are not able to see the progress. You must be able to catch the mind of God for you to be able to work with God. The Bible says that two cannot work together unless they agree. Hallelujah. Two cannot work together unless they agree. And one of the ways that God makes sure that we work together is by creating a picture through his word and through his promises, so that you can begin to see where God wants you in the next 5 years, one as a spirit, in the next 20 years. Now, many of us desire to be married. But have we caught the mind of God concerning marriage? Or you're just thinking about getting into marriage, smiling at each other on the table, laughing at each other, and that comes to an end. Have you seen yourself when 20 years married? Have you considered 30 years in marriage? Have you considered your children graduating, your children getting married, all those things? Now, if you're not ready for that, we are not planning for that, then we are not working with God, because our God is a God of progress. Hallelujah.
Amen.
But for us to be able to progress in God, we must know, number one, his mind. Number two, we must know our position in God. Say position.
Position.
Say position.
Position.
Now, I can see some of you have position. In fact, some of you know exactly where to sit when you come on Sunday. Like Lois sits there. She's positioned. Mr. Bokwa loves that seat. Position. Now, because of the camera, and I know only because of the camera, he's sitting over there. But I know if it was not for the camera, probably he would be behind there. We know that John, the sound guy, is always behind there. That is positioning. Such that if you came and you had something for John, you would know where to find him. But most of the time, we don't understand that God requires us to understand our positioning in him, so that we can be able to partake of the progress that he has for us. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
And so, the first thing that God did, when I go back to the foundation, the Garden of Eden, the first thing that God did was to create an environment for man to be able to live in, and only in that environment could man prosper. Now, let me say this. Everything is created to live in a certain environment. Everything. Be it a car, you can't store your car in water. You can't put your phone in water unless it is waterproof. Hallelujah. If you have fish, you can't put it in the hot water. Yes, it stays in water, but you can't put fish. If you have an aquarium and you begin to warm it up with your jiko and everything, because within a short short while, the fish will die. Everything lives in a certain environment and thrives in a certain environment. And the moment you take that thing outside that environment, then it begins to die. It begins to suffer. One as if you will. And so God, when he created man, he created an environment for him. And the Bible says in Genesis chapter 2, verse 8, we can be able to open our books there. Because this time, when you understand this, let me tell you, your life will change. What I'm about to teach you, your life will change. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Can somebody say a good amen?
Amen.
Now, what I'm telling you is that when you understand what I'm teaching you, your life will never remain the same. Even when you pray against witchcraft and witches, you'll be doing it from a position of confidence and not fear. Hallelujah. Now the Bible says in verse 8, and the Lord God planted a garden eastward in Eden, and there he put man whom he had formed. And God planted a garden in Eden, and there he put man who he had formed. God took man. Man was not told to look for the place. Man was not told to listen to the Holy Ghost to guide him to the place. God knew if he allows men to look for the place, he may not find it. So God took the man and put him in the Garden of Eden, because that was the environment that God wanted him to be. Now, if you look at the definition of the word Eden in Hebrew, it is written with about five strokes. Not actually about, there are 25 strokes. And every stroke has a meaning. You know, Hebrew language is one amazing language. Now, the word Eden has got five meanings. The first word, the first stroke, means spot. What does it mean? Spot. Say a spot.
Spot.
A spot.
A spot.
It's like the way you can come here and say, have you ever gone to Hollywood? You've never? Me, I have. You can be able to travel on your television. You can sit and watch Hollywood. What does it mean? That is traveling. So when those guys are about to win an award, there is a camera, or is it, there is a light. And you find when everybody looks at that light, because they know that light will suddenly beam on the person who is coming to receive the gift. Are we together? So that light is always spotted on the place where that person will stand. And when that person moves, the spot moves with him. So the Garden of Eden, the first definition is spot. Number two definition is moment. Say a moment.
Moment.
Not time, moment. Number three, it means presence. Presence. Hallelujah. That is the same word. Different meanings. Spot. Hallelujah. Moment. Presence. Number four, open door. Open door. Open door. That name. You know, we always talk about Eden. Because when you understand some of these things, you'll begin to enjoy God. God becomes more enjoyable when you understand some of these things. Number five, pleasant place. Pleasant place. Pleasant. Say about pleasant.
Pleasant.
Now, so I can define Eden as this. A spot on the earth for the moment where the presence of God is an open door towards heaven. Hallelujah. Now listen to me again, because I want you to catch this. Let me define it so that you can write it if you like. A spot on earth. A spot on earth. For the moment. A spot on the earth for the moment where the presence of God is an open door to heaven. Amen. So God takes man, places him in Eden, the spot where in that particular moment the presence of God is concentrated. And because the presence of God is in that place, then it is a connection or an open door towards heaven. So every time man was in Eden, he was receiving directly from God. Are we together? So God chose one place on planet Earth, a garden in Eden, and all the presence that was in heaven, it is like he pulls that door together and brings it to that place. One as if he went. So every time Adam is walking in that garden, He's enjoying communion with God. He's not worried about anything. And so what happens? God tells man, be fruitful in this place and begin to multiply it. So every place where it was in the Garden of Eden, God's presence was there. But God tells Abraham, Adam, be fruitful and multiply. In other words, begin to multiply this spot all over the earth, because I have created it here. But you have the responsibility as a believer now, as my creation, to begin to multiply so that you can get out of Eden and begin to bring this spot on every place on earth. One has to be it. Hallelujah.
Amen.
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 Now, when you are seated here, you are seated in an Eden. Because when God spoke to us to begin the shelter, then he chose a place. So in that place, that's why some of you, when you say, when I come to church, I feel so nice. Why? Because this place is a spot. And the moment you are seated in this place, then you are seated also in the presence of God. And as long as you are seated in the presence of God, then you are connected to heaven. One as if you were.
Amen.
And when you are connected to heaven, then you begin to draw from heaven. That's why some of you come out of this place and you say, I got a testimony after I came to church, because you encountered the spot. But what is the desire of God? For you to carry the spot. For you to carry the Eden. One as if you were. That is why God created in that way. God created man to live in the presence of God. Say, presence of God.
Yes.
Now, unfortunately, when many of us leave church, we leave the presence of God and we can't feel the presence of God because we do not know how to sustain that presence. So God created you to be in a certain environment. And when you're outside that environment, you cannot function properly, because that is not the environment that God created you to be. Now, for example, when God created the earth, it is the only planet that is inhabited by people. It's the only planet. No matter how scientists will keep on looking, oh, there was life in Mars, oh, Pluto, whatever, they will never find. God has already written his word. And most of the scientists are discovering, they're saying we have discovered, if they go to the Bible, they will find it there, because God wrote it a long time ago. It is only the planet Earth that is inhabited. What does he feel? Only planet Earth. There is no other place where you'll find people habited. And so when he created the earth, you find he also set certain things that are what you can call zero tolerance to some things. Now the earth, for example, is an environment where people live, whether they are born again or they are not born again. Now, if you change the environment of the earth, things will also change drastically. Now, for example, if you move the earth 4% or 4 degrees towards the sun, everybody will melt. 4 degrees. You will boil instantly. You will boil instantly. 4 degrees upwards. You will melt, all of us, including the pulpit, the pastor, it will come to an end. Now, if you move the earth 1% away from the sun, everything will freeze. So in other words, God created some things that you cannot tolerate. There is zero tolerance to changes of that environment. And in the same way, God created you as a human being, that when you move out of the presence of God, there are things that will not function properly. What has he viewed? And that is why you find so many of us are not progressing, because we keep on shifting. We move in God, we get back outside God. We move back to God, then you get back to. You keep on shifting. You deliberately sin, meaning you move out of the presence of God. So the moment you move out of the presence of God, though you are alive, there are things that have changed permanently. What has he do it? Now, we know very well that when Adam sinned, God had already spoken and said, you shall surely die. Now, did he die physically? No, he was not dead. So physical death is actually not so major. Adam lived for 930 years, yet God called him dead. Meaning he was a dead living man. What does he feel? He was a man who was so dead, but living. And so many of us, because we are alive, because no accident happened to you, you fornicated and you cheated and you committed adultery, you had pornography, you stole, and so you think it is okay. God did not do anything. I'm all right. I'm walking. Adam walked for 930 years and he was a dead man. The presence of God had already moved away. So there are things that could not work in Adam because he had moved away. He had already broken the tolerance that God had created for man. He had already broken the boundaries that God had broken for man. And so we need to understand, as you sit over here, you cannot live the way you want and expect God to progress your life and to keep on. Even when you hear the urgency in prayer, the urgency to intercede, the urgency to kneel down and to pray for people that death may not attack them, because there are some people who have broken the boundaries that God had created for us. What does it do with?
Amen.
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 Hallelujah.
Amen.
So because you sinned yesterday and nothing happened, it does not necessarily mean, thank you so much. You understand the Bible? Amen. Hallelujah.
Amen.
And that is what has been happening. You find many Christians, we do things that are against the law of God. And because he doesn't do anything, we think that he has been quiet. We think it is okay. And we don't realize that we have taken a journey. God has already stepped out. And he's like, I can't tolerate that. I can't watch you go into that place, watch pornography for 2 hours, and you expect me to keep on having my spot with you, following you in every place. I will move away. And so that is why you find sometimes intercession happening. Why? Because God sometimes is putting a burden. There is something, you see, and I will explain next Sunday more. I wish we can all understand what death is. Because death is so powerless. Death is so powerless. Because the Bible says the sting of death is sin. So without sin, death cannot be able to sting us. One as if we were.
Amen.
Without sin, death cannot sting. The only thing that gives death a sting is sin. And Jesus has already dealt with that still. But we need to understand that something about our position in God that will help us to live with a better understanding. One as a free way.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Our position in God. We need to progress. We can't take things for granted. We can't just wake up in the morning and do the things the way we want to do it. God has got his standards. And he has given you his spirit. He has given you his word that you cannot break some of these standards, because the standards of God are so high. I will surely, for example, if Naphtali, who is programming this thing or shooting a video in this thing, if right now he lifted up that video and released it and dropped it to the ground, it will take a miracle if that thing will be okay. If you take that computer that you have on there and drop it to the ground, I'm very sure by the time you connect it, it will not be working. Now we expect that we can do the things anyhow. We lift ourselves, we move ourselves from where God has placed us, and we drop ourselves to the ground and expect that by the time God takes us from where we are, we will be okay. There will be something that will have happened. But our God is so caring, because I want to show you in the scriptures, because I'm here to scare you. Don't say that I'm not here to scare you. I'm here to scare you. God has it here. Hallelujah. Because sometimes you need to be scared so that you can be able to live right. So that you can be able to, because some of us have got the sentence of death on us. Because of the things that we do it. And you know, our conscience begins to die when we do something continually. Today you will steal, so nothing happens. So tomorrow you steal again, nothing happens. Then you come to church and you say, Father, have mercy. So you think mercy has been acquired. So then you go back and steal, nothing happens. And you think that nothing is changing. Something is changing. What does it feel? But we need to understand, there are blessings in being in Christ, said in Christ. Because I'm coming to that position. Because God desires that you continue to live in Eden. And by showing you in the scriptures, when you got born again, God moved you from where you are and put you in Eden. Say Eden.
Yeah.
And that's why if you read the book of Romans chapter 12 verse 5, I just want us to go there. Romans
chapter 12, verse 5. Romans chapter 12, verse 5. So if you have a Bible, you open it there. Or you look at our digital Bible. And I can assure you that one, you cannot underline it. So you can only look at it and leave it there. And after that, it is no longer on the wall. So Romans chapter 12, verse 5. Now the Bible says, let's start from verse 4. For as we have many members in one body, but all the members do not have the same functions. So we being many are one body in Christ, and individually members of one another. So we being many are one body in Christ. One body in Christ. Say one body.
One body.
In Christ. So we are seated here, all of us, differently. But in the eyes of God, we are one body. One body. But where? In Christ. I want you to mark those words. In Christ. Say in Christ.
In Christ.
Because my focus is that word, in. That word is so powerful. Because when you understand that word, it will change your life. Hallelujah. So we are one body in Christ, though as individual members. We may be separate, we have different functions, but we are all in Christ. Say, I am in Christ. Now I want us to open the book of Ephesians chapter 2, verse 6. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 6. Because I'm going to the spot of God, to the Eden of God. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 6. And then say amen.
Amen.
Now the Bible says, in fact, let us start from verse 5. Even when we were dead in trespasses, God made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved. And raised us up together and made us sit together in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus. When we got born again, God raised us up. And the word says that he made us to sit together. As the body of Christ, we are seated together. And he says we are seated where? Where are we seated? Say in heavenly places. Say in heavenly places. Say it again, in heavenly places. Because you need to understand, you are seated in Shujamon. But in the spirit, in the real sense, in the truth, you are seated in heavenly places. Now, in heavenly places, where else? In Christ Jesus. Amen? In heavenly places, in Christ Jesus. I want you to mark that one, in Christ. Because that is where I'm going, in Christ. All of us are not outside Christ. As long as you are born again, you are seated together in heavenly places, in Christ Jesus. Let us go to Colossians chapter 3. No, Ephesians chapter 3, chapter 2, verse 13. I'm emphasizing something. Chapter 2, verse 13 says, but now, in Christ Jesus, you who are once far off have been brought near by the blood of Jesus. But now, say now, in Christ. Now, do you know in Christ, you have been brought near? Now, Patrick, come. Now, the Bible says, you, because of sins, you are once far away. But now, in Christ Jesus, you have been brought near. Hallelujah.
Amen.
You have been brought near by the blood of Jesus Christ. That means you are in Christ because of the blood of Jesus. Amen?
Amen.
You have been brought near by the blood of Jesus Christ. But you need to understand something where I'm going. Now, in Christ. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Thank you so much. Near. You are near your blessing. Say amen.
Amen.
You are near your husband. Say amen.
Amen.
You are near your car in Jesus' name.
Amen.
And you are near.
Amen.
Because the Bible says that you have been brought near by the blood of Jesus to the commonwealth of Israel. Now Colossians chapter 3 verse 3. Colossians chapter 3. Colossians chapter 3 verse 3. Now mark that word. In. Now verse 3 says, for you died. And your life is hidden with Christ in God. For you died. For you died. For you died. Say, I died.
I died.
Can you die twice? I'm asking you, can you die twice?
No.
I'm asking once again, can you die twice?
No.
Now today I'm teaching. I'm teaching because when you understand this thing, you will change your perspective. Now the Bible says you died. Now if you died, why should we be afraid of death? For you died and your life is hidden with Christ in God. Now this is, where is the smaller bag? No, let me start with this one. Now this is Jesus Christ, and it's not this bag, I'm just giving a demonstration. Now this is Jesus. So Jesus dies, and is lifted up by God, raised up, and put in heavenly places. Now, we are assuming the altar is the heavenly places. Now, the Bible says, then you, assuming that you are this, because of the sin that you have committed, the sin of Adam, you died. Because the Bible says, by one man, death entered all men. By one man. So Adam sinned and all of us died. But when Jesus came and he died on the cross and rose again, then the Bible says when we receive him, we resurrect and we are raised up and we are brought together to the heavenly places. And now the Bible says your life is hidden with Christ. So there is your life. Can you see the yellow?
No.
Can you see the yellow?
No.
Can you see it?
No.
I want to hear somebody say, now if you can see it, unless you are bionic eyes. Can you see the yellow thing?
No.
Now that is you in Christ. So the devil can't see you. One as if you were.
Amen.
The witches cannot see you.
Amen.
Amen.
Now if you cannot see what is inside you, how can the witch see? Now when a witch tries to look at you, he's like, I see Jesus only. Because your life is hidden with Christ. Now look at that dimension. Now this is God. I'm using that scripture. For you died, and your life is hidden with Christ in God. I wish I had a smaller bag, because this one is big. Hallelujah. Now this is the big bag is God. Hallelujah.
Amen.
The smaller bag is Jesus. And then the yellow thing is you. You are hidden. See, I'm hidden.
I'm hidden.
You are hidden in Eden. Hallelujah.
Amen.
So when you walk around, now let me ask you a very simple question. Assuming I wanted to shoot, or the devil wanted to shoot you. Now, so he aims because he's here. Who does he shoot first?
God.
Now, is God shootable?
No.
Now I'm asking you, is God shootable?
No.
Now, assuming the bullet penetrates, there is another bag.
Jesus,
amen? So Jesus died. Jesus died and he rose again. And the Bible says he defeated death. Because the Bible says it is appointed for man to die once. So by the fact that he died, death cannot kill him again. Are we together?
Yes.
So even if when the bullet comes, so who does he hit next? Assuming it.
Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Yes.
Are you seeing the protection that you have?
Yes.
So you are already in Christ, in God. Say, I am in Christ.
I am in Christ.
Say, I am in Christ.
I am in Christ.
In God.
In God.
Therefore, no evil can come near me.
No evil can come near me.
Now, so many of you say that scripture from the point of fear. Because you are like trying to work it out. You know the way you start a machine? You warm it up. No evil shall come near me. No evil shall come near me. No evil shall. Then you bust out. Because you think by saying it more times, it is working. Yes, it is okay to confess. But I wish you're confessing from this position. When you look at the devil and say, no evil can come near me. No weapon fashioned against me can prosper. Because for any weapon to work against me, it has to hit God first. And no weapon can hit our God, Jehovah. Hallelujah.
Amen.
No weapon can be fashioned against God. The Bible says there is no plan There is no cancer against our God. Amen? There is no. So anybody planning anything against you is planning against themselves. That's what the Bible says. Whoever digs a pit shall fall into it. Whoever digs a pit can do what? Fall into it. Can you imagine Kenya, for example, planning to attack America? Now I told you to imagine. We'll be digging a pit for a while. No, so when the devil tries to target you, he's actually digging a pit against himself. Amen?
Amen.
That's what the Bible says, that whoever digs a pit shall fall into it. But I'm now coming to another scripture that will blow your mind. Let us go to Acts chapter 17, verse 28.
What are you doing?
Amen. Acts 17. Verse 28, because today our lives will change. Say amen.
Amen.
Today our lives will change.
Amen.
Say a better amen.
Amen.
I'm saying today your life will change. By understanding this, can you just tell God, God, give me understanding?
Amen.
Say it like you mean it. Father, give me understanding.
Father, give me understanding.
Because when you understand this thing, it will change you. I was laying a foundation. Now the Bible says in verse 28. Let's just, in fact, we can start it. Verse 26. And he has made us from one blood, every nation of men, to dwell on all the face of the earth. And has determined there the appointed times and the boundaries of their dwellings. So for somebody to say that, in Pakai, because to Yawabi, when you see Africa divided the way it is divided, it's because God divided it a long time ago. Hallelujah.
Amen.
He already says, and he has determined the appointed times and boundaries of their dwellings, so that they should seek the Lord in hope that they might grope for him and find him. Though he is not far from each one of us, God is not far from each one of us. Though what does God say? That the reason why God has put you in different places is so that we may seek him and grope for him. To mtafute, we might find him. So that we can be able to bring the support of his presence in our homes, born as we feel it, in our workplaces, in the marketplace. Such that when you say, when you go to, for example, you work in the city center, you can be able to say, no weapon fashion again in the city center can happen because I live here. Amen? If there is something happening in your estate, you can be able to say, because I brought the presence of God in this place, nothing can happen to this place. God has appeared. So, but the Bible says, that is not far from each one of us, for in him we live. Say, in him we live. Say,
in him we live.
I'm hoping to communicate on this. In him we live. In him we live. In him we live. Now can you imagine you live in God? You think you live in Kayole? Now let me ask you. If you live in God, can you lack? Now I'm asking you. Now answer me back. If you live in God, can you lack?
No.
Now if you live in God, can cancer live in God?
No.
Now I'm asking you. Now can cancer live in God?
No.
Can poverty be found in God?
No.
Can sickness be found in God?
No.
Can the devil be found in God?
No.
Can evil come to God?
No.
Can calamity come to God?
No.
Can a dead live in God?
No.
In him you live. Say amen.
Amen.
In him you live.
Amen.
Now if you understand this, something will change in you. That you live in God. Now listen, I don't know whether I wish there was a lady who is blessed with the fruit of the womb, who is pregnant. Now, that child lives in the womb, true or false. So if you are here, you can volunteer, then just come and see. Now, that child lives in the mother. What has he given? Amen. So that child can be able to say, in my mother I live. Amen?
Amen.
Now that child does not wake up to do anything. He's just living. When the mother eats, the child eats. Two of us. When the mother sleeps, the child sleeps. Two of us. When the mother is happy, the child is happy. Hallelujah.
Amen.
I used to. I'm experienced. I remember. Sometimes Pastor Jane would come and feel the Mother Kiki. This girl is happy. At that time when she's very happy. One has a few. So when the mother goes to wash clothes, does the child wash?
No.
I'm asking, does the child wash?
No.
No. In other words, the child is at rest because in her mother or his mother, she or he lives. Now, the moment you live in God, the sickness cannot come near you. Amen?
Amen?
Sickness should not come near you when you understand this picture. For in him we live. Sickness cannot come near you. Now, I was watching a certain documentary, and you can go on, and probably you have seen it somewhere. But there's this place, I think it's in the US and also in Japan, where they have created a big class in a zoo. And you see small children standing over there, and there's a lion on the other side. And the lion is there doing this, wanting, feeling like, I wish I could eat this child. But the lion cannot be able to come on that side because of the thick glass that has separated the child from the animal. Now, also in the same place, I have seen a woman who is sitting and she's looking behind at the lion. And you know the lion is like trying to come. And suddenly the lion comes and jumps on the glass and the woman screams. The woman begins to scream, and that's the way we are. Because the devil comes and he's threatening, he says, I will kill you. And because you don't realize in him you live, that you are protected by him, you scream in God and you're like, God! So you lose your faith. And suddenly what you fear comes upon you. But it was not God's plan. Because in him you live. So even if the devil wants to come and get you, he can't get you because you are in him. Say in him.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
So HIV comes and tries to target you. And he cannot locate you because in him you live. One has a view. Poverty targets you, enters your mind, but you are still outside. You are on the inside of God, but poverty is on the outside. So, but because you don't know you live in God, who has everything? Who has everything? God has got everything that you need. Because you live in him, you don't understand that poverty cannot come near you. So you keep on binding poverty. Poverty, I bind you. Poverty, can you imagine that child standing behind the glass wall? And that child, he's saying to the zookeepers, crying, please hold the lion. Lion, I bind you. You will not eat me. You will not do this. The zookeeper will just be laughing. It can't eat you. And that's how God looks at us. Because we don't understand where we are. That we die and our lives are hidden in Christ, in God. What does he do? Now we live in God. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Now, you cannot be in the two places at the same time. You can't be in Nairobi and in Kampala at the same time. You can say, I live in Kayole, in Nairobi, in Kenya. But you cannot say, I live in Kayole, in Kampala. You can't say that. Can you say that? You can't. You can't. So you need to understand that as a believer, you live in God. And when you live in God, nothing is lacking in God. Say, nothing is lacking.
Nothing is lacking.
So from today, no poverty.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
No more poverty in your life because you live in him.
Amen.
Now, if you go to Rwanda, the people who live in Rwanda live in a certain environment. You will find there are trees that grow outside, as Pastor Jane likes to say, trees that grow outside. So the environment is cooler there. Now before you enter the main gate, there is scrutiny of the vehicles that are getting in there. Because that environment is a protected environment. Now let us even go further. If you go to Two Rivers, you will find before you get into Two Rivers, there are very many requirements for you to enter. But the moment you enter there, you suddenly feel the environment has changed. Even the way people talk there, if you're not very confident, you may begin to talk that way. Because everybody is just talking, your hallelujah. Everybody's talking like that. So if you, even the change, you change the way you walk, because you suddenly realize those people don't walk the way everybody else walks. There is a confidence of where they are. Hallelujah. They feel a certain level of security, which may be imagined, but at the end of the day, it's a different environment. Now, if you go to that place, you'll be told there is Java here, you'll be told there is California here, there is Kondaiva. You'll be told there is, wait for that, a kiosk, at an M-Pesa, but you'll not find an M-Pesa. Why? Because that environment is catered for specific people, and you're one of them, amen?
Amen.
You're even higher than that, one has
to do it.
Hallelujah!
Amen.
But the people who stay there have got access to some amenities that some of us cannot access in our places. Now, if you go to the toilets there, they are higher. They are, some of them are better than the toilets that we go to. Hallelujah.
Amen.
In fact, the toilets there are, some of them are cleaner than the plots that we live in. But the moment you live in that place, you have access to all these things. What does it mean? The beauty that is inside that place, the protection that is in that place, all the good that is in that place, is yours because you live in that place. Hallelujah.
Amen.
One if you were.
Amen.
Now what I'm trying to say, when you live in God, then you are in the spot of His presence. And in the spot of His presence, there is no lack. Now the second part says, and for in Him we live and move. Say move. Now I know, if you are carrying the fruit of the womb, you have refused to come here. But I'm assuming now I'm that person. And I'm carrying. Amen? I'm carrying. Now, this child, the mother moves one step. Does the child move?
Yes.
Now I'm asking, does the child move?
Yes.
Now, does the child move?
Yes.
Does the child move according to the child's ability or the mother's ability?
The mother's ability.
So in Him we move. Now God moves, we also moved supernaturally. Amen?
Amen.
And that's why I came to prophesy that God will do some major moves in your life that will shock you.
Amen.
Hallelujah. God will begin to do major moves in your life that will shock you.
Amen.
When you understand where you are, because this thing comes by understanding. When you begin to understand. Now, Joseph understood that. From prison to prime minister. David, from a shepherd to a king. Because God moved. And David moved.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
And God is always moving forward. That means your life from today will not move backwards in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Because our God is moving. Our God is moving. Now, according to our ability, when we were in Brucewood, we used to be 120 maximum. Let's say to me, I come in the bus, yeah, Kadanga Success. The ones that used to go to Muranga, Kadanga Success. Now, we were full, but we were feeling very comfortable in that place. Then God moved to Greenspan. What has He been? God moved. Now, our rent in that place, which we were praying and fasting for, and calling for intercessory prayers to believe God for rent of 8,000, was so huge. But suddenly God moves to a place where our rent is about 10 times more. But because it is Him who moved, it was not our responsibility to find the rent, because when He moves, He provides.
Amen.
One as if He were. When He moves, He provides. Now, can you imagine if the pregnant woman lives in Soweto and the next day she moves and begins to live in Runda? Will you also be living in Runda?
Yes.
Now, if the child is there, will the child remain in Soweto or the child will go to Rwanda? Hallelujah.
Amen.
Now, because that's what I'm trying to tell you is that you need to start connecting. That's why we say the spot on earth for a moment when the presence of God is an open gate to heaven. Because the moment you are able to connect to where God has moved, then you have faith to also to be moved by God into that place. Are we together?
Yes.
Because everywhere God is moving is a higher level, it's a better place.
Amen.
What does he feel it? So, in him, and you have debt. Are you on a debt level? If you have debt, debt cannot survive in God's presence.
Yes.
Are we together?
Amen.
So I declare debt dies in your life in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Now, could you be saying that you are poor? Poverty cannot survive in God's presence.
Amen.
It cannot survive. It cannot survive. So if you are in God, you cannot be poor. That's why when you hear some of us say, I cannot be poor, it is not right, it is understanding.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Say, I cannot be poor.
I cannot be poor.
Now, assuming you have acquired sickness from the devil who is on the glass behind, and so you took that sickness, and now you suddenly realize you are in God. Can sickness survive in God?
No.
So I declare you are healed in Jesus' name.
Amen.
I declare you are healed in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Now, is God limited?
No.
Can God be limited?
No.
That means if God is going to Uganda, to Cameroon, to Nigeria, to wherever he's going, he's unstoppable. And that means from today you become unstoppable because you're moving with God.
Amen.
Say, I am unstoppable.
I am unstoppable.
Say, I am unstoppable.
I am unstoppable.
Can God be stopped from getting into America?
No.
So if you want to go to America, you will go. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Because it is God who is moving. Born as if we were.
Amen.
Our God is not. Can God be defeated in battle?
No.
Now can you imagine? Now, assuming this is that woman, and she knows like one, and she's attacked by thugs. Who will fight, the child or the woman?
The woman.
So why are you fighting battles?
Hallelujah.
The Lord shall fight for you,
Amen.
And you shall hold your peace.
Amen.
The Lord shall fight for you.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Because God designed you to be at rest. The only thing that gets you out from this presence is sin. Amen.
Amen.
The only thing that gets you out of that presence is sin. Number two, the only thing that gets you out of that presence, fear. 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 Now, I'll give a small story as I wind up. Now, I read a book, I think it was written by John Austin. There was this particular gentleman, I don't know whether it was a gentleman or a lady, but used to work for a milk company. Now, the milk company had refrigerators. And as she was going checking, I can't remember whether it was a man or a woman, as he was going checking the refrigerators, so were like containers. She got into one of the containers, and unfortunately, the wind blew the door, and it automatically knocked her in. She couldn't get out. So she began to yell, she began to knock, she began to do everything, and nobody could hear because it was in the evening. And so in the morning, everybody's looking for this person. And they begin to open. As they open one of these refrigerators, container, they find this person dead at the door. Now when they open, they were shocked. He was taken to hospital. I can't remember if it was a man or a woman, taken to hospital. Now, the postmortem showed that the person died of hypothermia, frozen. Now, the most amazing thing, the container was a broken down container that had room temperature. That is a true story, room temperature. But the person died because of freezing to death. death. So what happened? The lie entered our head that you are in a refrigerated container, and the body accepted it. She began to shiver and eventually died. The Bible says the fear of a man is a snare. The fear of a man is a snare. All of you are in Christ if you are born again, but there are things you fear. You fear poverty, you fear sickness, you fear accidents, you fear all these things. But because you don't know that you are in God, those things come upon you. And God can do nothing because it is your fear. One as if you were. Number two, when you sin, you break the hedge. It is like that child who was in the zoo. Now if that child took a stone and broke the glass, automatically the animal will eat the person. The animal will come and eat. And so that is what happens. We are in God. But what happens when we sin, we break the protection. Because God cannot protect sin. God cannot be defined. So the head becomes open. And suddenly the devil who was trying to get you catches you, pulls you outside, and that's why you can hear a believer die. What does it feel?
Amen.
When we sin, we break the hedge that protects us from the calamities of the world. And that is why we have to strive. We have to strive because we are connected to God. We are connected to the life of God. We have to believe that we are righteous. And because we are made righteous, we cannot see. Hallelujah.
Amen.
We cannot see. Do dead people see?
No.
Now I'm asking you, do dead people see?
No.
Can you find a dead man stealing?
No.
Can you find a dead man fornicating?
No.
Now I'm asking you, some of you in the camp, like a what one of the people are. Can you find a dead man stealing?
No.
Is it a good no?
No.
It's because some of you don't want to say a big no because that's what you want. Colossians 3 verse 3. Look at that scripture because I want it to enter your head. And that's why I'm asking you. For you died. Say, I died.
I died.
Say, I died.
I died.
In fact, the Bible says you died to see. You died to eat. For you died and your life is hidden with Christ in God. Now I'm asking again, do dead people see?
No.
Can dead people steal?
No.
Can dead people fornicate?
No.
Can dead people watch pornography?
No.
Can dead people lie?
No.
Can dead people fear?
No.
The only thing they don't have is faith. The only thing that they don't have. So when you got born again, you died. And you resurrected in God. Amen?
Amen.
So from today, you need to realize that in God, you have everything that you need. What does it feel?
Amen.
You have everything that you need. A witch should not scare you. A witch should not scare you. Should not. Because when you go up country now, you are the spotlight of God. You remember that light that I began with? Now, when you see such kind of a light coming to your village, will you hang around or will you run? Now, that light, which is the presence of God covering you, walks with you as long as you are born again and you are living right. And so, when you go up country and the witches see you, they may try to throw arrows. But remember that you are in God. Say, in God.
In God.
They cannot harm you. All you need to say is to declare, no weapon fashioned against me shall prosper. Hallelujah.
Amen.
No weapon fashioned against me shall prosper. And why does your voice become powerful? Now, if you are inside God, when you speak, you are speaking through God. You are speaking through what?
Love.
Through God. So your voice is magnified by God. The people that hear you, hear God speaking. So when you say no weapon fashioned against me can prosper, the witches fear, that is God speaking. What has he feared? Hallelujah.
Amen.
Declare now, from today,
from today,
no more poverty.
No more poverty.
Say it like you mean, from today,
from today,
no more poverty.
No more poverty.
Because I live in God.
Because I live in God.
From today,
from today,
no more sicknesses.
No more sicknesses.
Because I live in God.
Because I live in God.
From today,
from today,
progressing.
I am progressing.
Because God is moving.
Because God is moving.
And I live in Him.
And I live in Him.
From today.
From today.
No weapon.
No weapon.
Can touch me.
Can touch me.
Because I am in God.
Because I am in God.
From today.
From today.
No more lack.
No more lack.
No more lack.
No more lack.
Because I'm provided for by God.
Yes. Because I'm provided for.
In Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name.
Now, can you imagine that child in the womb? That child does not need to pray for food. Because as long as the mother eats, the child eats. That child does not have to cry for clothing. The child is naked, but clothed by the mother. Amen?
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Have you even seen this lady over here? From the time you came in, you have been holding that child. That child does not even care whether you're making noise. Since I'm in the presence of my mother. What as if you were
crying?
If the child cries, the mother will give the child food from heaven. What as if you were?
Amen.
You know what I mean? Hallelujah.
Amen.
And that child is not afraid of anything because it is with the mother. How much more when that child is inside? If the mother gets sick of malaria, the child inside. Doctor, do they get sick? The doctor. There is one portrait that child. If a mother died with a child who is alive in the stomach, that child will not die immediately. That child may stay alive because of the provision that was there. Maybe after 2 weeks. Did you see the one of Solai? A child was found alive almost a week later on the back of the mother. The mother is dead. Because I'm pretty sure that child, in their innocence, will say, "Uni mama, mama tukunee tu hapa. To mama. I am safe. Even if the water is flowing, with my mother around, I am safe." What does it feel?
Amen.
That's the way we are supposed to do. Let us hand on God. Amen.
Amen.
Hand on God in God. Amen.
Amen.
And let that consciousness that you are in God, that you are moving, when God moves, you are moving. And finally, he says, "In Him I have my being." In Him I have my being. What is being? Being is the essence of life. All that you need to be who you are supposed to be. Hallelujah.
Amen.
All that you need to be who you're supposed to be. That is, in Him I live, in Him I move, in Him I have my being. You require peace, you have it. You require joy, in Him I have mine. Whatever I need in God, it is available. From today, enjoy the Eden of God.
Amen.
Enjoy the Eden of God.
Amen.
Enjoy the Eden of God.
Amen.
From today, nothing shall bother you.
Amen.
Because you are in God.
Amen.
From today, nothing shall harass you.
Amen.
Because you are in God.
Amen.
You are highly protected.
Amen.
You are highly favored.
Amen.
You are progressing in God.
Amen.
In Jesus' mighty name.
Hallelujah, Lord. Today I want to say I need more of you. I desire more of you, Lord. I'm thirsty for you, Spirit. I'm thirsty for